or at next meeting. I've already made up my mind. I'm bringing it up at the next meeting. Do the men want to hold the nomination at the local union hall and then hold the election at the mine? It's going to be up to our members, whichever way they want.
That's what the strategic supervisor, the labor department.
Well, now that's what I'm bringing up at our next meeting. If they want to hold the election at the mines, the local union office, well and good, I'd be tickled to death.
Since this is an informal thing and an educational thing, I thought I would inform each and every person what has been taking place for years and years.
I might add, Mr. Callan, that what we're all seeing is a very democratic discussion, which was impossible, a generation ago inside the union. We're even discussing procedure democratic. So I think we're very grateful to you, really, for adding, to the discussion some of these points of procedure which really go to the heart of a debate around what is, democracy. And I think we're very grateful to you for adding these things. I want to thank all of our panel members who have been here prior to the arrival of Mr. Miller. Or maybe sit down there. Ladies and gentlemen, we've been holding this panel discussion, and I think it's been very valuable on the structure of local unions, the district, and the sub-district of the International Union prior to the arrival of Mr. Miller, our guest speaker tonight. And since the arrangements made through an intermediary for getting him here indicated that he'd like a few minutes of having a general idea of what we've tried to cover, I've taken the liberty, since we have people present who are not in the course, I'm not sure on how to work these buttons, but of about a 5-minute quick preview to try to cover the territory. We've covered at different points, and that way be able to communicate with some of you who are not in the course generally, as well as prior to introducing Mr. Miller. So with your permission, if I've got this system on right, I think we'll be able to. What I'd like to do is just quickly go through these now. We have taken up a lot of things from the mechanization of the mines today to these very early days, 150 to 200 years ago, in Scotland, Wales, and England, where these were the underground conditions. That's a woman stripped to the waist, or women in the mines and children pushing in the rear, extremely low seams on a slope, extremely primitive conditions, and we jump to the hand loading days and the mule in the mines. Very often that's a famous picture because the white mule contrasts. So the hand loading days we went through, we very often forget that scenes like this took place in West Virginia until World War I. It's very difficult to understand the militancy of the miner. The fact that some men became leaders of the United Mine Workers at its district level, who at age 21 or 24 had been underground for the majority of their lives already. This is a sampling of children at some of the mines just before World War I. The miners were forced to meet under secret conditions in the woods because of the eviction and the cruelty, the discharge, and the throwing out of all their worldly goods. That headline in the big New York newspaper means J.P. Morgan. This is 1902. That's an 8-column headline to give you an idea of what molded the miners. The orders used to go out straight from the big people as to what to do. And in return, that kind of violence of company deputies, National Guards, U.S. Army in the southern part of West Virginia, this is at Ludlow. The miners, in turn, you can see, are not without their weapons and their arms in response to this kind of thing. Those are what they call company thugs or gunmen at Ludlow, moving in with a protected position of boxcars where the women and children were burned to the ground and lost their lives. The battle conditions required truce flags. Mother Jones, the famous martyr of the movement, together the man in the upper right there is John Lawson, the great leader of the Colorado Army. That's Pink Creek and Cabin Creek, 1912. And again, the miners all evicted, no food stamps, no unemployment compensation. The United Mine Workers provided the tents, provided the food, provided the clothing. In turn, the violence in some of the battles, these were the kinds of arms captured in some of the battles like at Blair Mountain at Logan County. In this part of the state, this was the immediate situation in the 1920s. Evicted from their homes, the union issued them, I think some of you that were here for the labor history slide heard some of the older men talk, issued them 2x4s to build the barracks, and children were raised in those barracks for as long as 5 years, including distinguished businessmen, or Jimmy Manchin, who's a member of Archmore's team today. Children like that were raised in the barracks at Farmington and Barrackville and off to Scott's Run. The raids across the bridge, the evictions in Scott's Run, entire families, all their worldly goods because of union membership. The children of Owings Mine, you can see every ethnic group, black and white, every lesson of brotherhood taught by the union instead of by intellectuals or government principles as today. The barracks again, entire families. I think many of you remember Mr. Horniak, who looked like a banker and fooled some of you at the labor history thing because he came dressed so well, telling you the union issued bacon, beans, and coffee. Three things. Once a week, he went with his daddy each week to get them in the 1920s. And then Lewis, in an early pose here on the far left, is the very young looking, about 22 years old, Bill Blizzard, who later became president of the district. Frank Keeney, Fred Mooney, the elected leaders of the district who later were removed. Typical towns, a scene out of Granttown. The Monongah Band, which was famous and became world famous, what the miners thought of either editors or judges that tried to do anything to their union as late as World War II and beyond. The terrible disasters at West Frankfort, and then this is Lewis at Centralia, 1951. These were the big disasters of that era. And Lewis's statements before Senate committees, the man whose genius brought about so many things such as the CIO and the fund which were reviewed and other things, the whole organization of the union, the Section 7A, 1933, but who also removed from office the elected district leaders and destroyed the middle management level of any organization. We reviewed all the kinds of underground conditions and the modern mechanization, all the way from continuous miners and machines that can rip out coal faster than transportation systems, to the long walls, to the short walls. We've had reviews here by mine management, an idea of what stripping and the western stripping can do. We're going to be studying more and more of this. The mine workers were the union formed in 1890 as an industrial union when the nation was dominated by craft unions and maintained an industrial union pose. This is Llewellyn Shaft, Farmington number 9. A portion of the annual wreath placement by the widows in Evelyn. Again, some of the most famous disasters, Monongah in 1907, Farmington number 9, both in this county, bringing on federal legislation. Then the newly elected leadership of the mine workers today, he drives, this is a scene from Brookside, the president of the International Union visiting the miners at Brookside in a desperate and bitter struggle against the power company, went out, and then that last scene was, I suppose, related to the fact that in introducing Mr. Miller to you. It was my privilege, although I had not met him, that he asked Dr. Rasmussen and I to represent the him because he couldn't go to the University of Michigan about a year ago when a physician, and physicians are usually well-paid, scientific men, saw fit to attack both coal miners and their black lung benefits on seemingly rather involved grounds. And that response was delivered, and we appreciated the confidence that was shown us in attempting to respond before those several hundred graduate students at the University of Michigan to this very unwarranted attack on the men who go deep into the bowels of the earth to dig the coal that makes the energy that keeps this country going. There's going to be no flowery introduction of Mr. Miller, at least from me. I'll say two negatives, and he can say what he pleases when he gets here. First, what he is not, and what, in my opinion, I have my views of these things since I was a very young boy when I went to work for Mr. Lewis, and I had a break and disagree with him as well, so I had my little time in life on these issues. One, he did not come up through the hierarchy of the union. Unlike American labor leaders today, he did not come up through dominating a big local union, a base of 400 or 2,000 men, then moving to district leadership, and then moving into the international. And that has an enormous influence in making whatever is different about man. The other thing, I don't have the same feelings of Ben Franklin or some of the media, which I think have both overdone his rank and file background and then have tried to undercut. I would say that first negative, and the other negative is that he was not always in the industry. In the last few years before he assumed power, although the newspapers don't report it, he had a unique experience, as I as an observer see it, he can correct me. But most American labor leaders never had it since the 1930s. Having black lung, being in and out of the industry, he mixed with people who were active in other fields, liberal lawyers, doctors, people fighting for black lung. He was a lector for the McGovern ticket, and I don't know, in view of the fact that the man who beat him has most of his colleagues presently in jail, that he was on the wrong side on that. And he did other things. He served in storefronts. He met other kinds of people. And all of us are molded by our experience. I don't know how much molding this was, but this was a molding of a man that most American labor leaders don't get today. Those in the 30s got it. They rubbed shoulders with a lot of different people. So you won't get from me a big flower introduction. It's my honor to introduce the president of the International Union of the United Mine Workers, Arnold Miller.
Some of the slides and scenes that you saw here, if you'll permit me to lay some groundwork for what I hope to contribute here tonight, was stationed in the area where I'm from. I was born and raised in Cabinetry. I know where the tents are talked about. Most recently, it was 1931. We had a tent colony again. This is not very well documented. The area which I grew up in, I remember what the ball and stuff were. And I remember when they declared martial law last year. I know what the coal miners called the militia. I saw them. They called them tin horns. They had the old World War I helmets and brass leggings. And we had no union. The busted again. I saw what the ball and stuff were done to on the old approach that today. With that kind of background, the fact that it was really kind of rough, I go with somebody I don't remember in 1972. One of them asked for my politics was. been a Democrat all my life, but Hoover made one of them. Well, you wasn't old enough to work in the Hoover Depression. They call it Depression in those days. Today they call it Recession, or whatever they got some fancy term for it. I wasn't old enough to work, but I was sure old enough to eat. And I went to the table, I had to look to see if there's enough on the table to go around. Not what it was, but whatever it was up to me there. Despite the fact that I was born and raised in Cabtree, a lot of historical background and nothing documented. I'm now in the process of doing it. I'm fortunate to have an old fellow that rent from me that's 100 years old. He's now assembling all his records and making them available. We will hopefully go back and document some of the information that was forgotten down over the years. But despite the fact that the area where I was born and raised, and whole matter all my life, I never saw it until I lived my life. I never saw an international brother until I came to Washington in 1969. After we had staged an uprising in our home state, the commanders himself decided it was time to do something about a serious problem. It soon became evident that if we got anything done at all, we was going to do it on our own. I don't want to dwell too much on the past, because it's the future now that is important to the economies and the people in this state, as well as the people in this country. I firmly believe in union democracy. Ever since the first day I became a member of this union, I believe that every people ought to be elected. And that right was not granted. The last district official, my home district, 17, that was elected was someone who Mr. Ross referred to, Frank Keeper. 1931, made a valiant effort to try to organize again. But he was trying to organize some kind of a union for miners. This was when the evictions came again. They didn't come like they would make a day in a court of law and ask you to remove yourself, maybe help you carry out your belongings. They come and picked up what little bit of belongings the miners had, threw it out in the middle of the roof. Now some of the younger folks today might say, we wouldn't tolerate that. Well, under martial law and under the condition then, there's very little you could do. Because when they done it to a coal miner then, there were three thugs for a coal miner. And they would literally beat your brains out if you tried to fight it. As a result of what I was told in 1969, former district president in my home district, when I asked him to help us coal miners do something about the serious lung problem, he wasn't sticking his neck out for no one. I said, somewhere up the road, we will have the rights that we deserve, that we will have elections, that we will elect you out, because in this district, as large as it is, I don't believe it's 500 members knows who you are, because you never got out of the district office. Days in retirement, a very average retirement, which I don't think you can serve. So much for that. I want to identify the name. But with union democracy comes a lot of responsibility. I'm a firm believer that anyone who serves the public or anyone who serves in a labor organization ought to be judged and elected by his peers. As I said in our convention in 1973, I believe it was Lincoln who said, any man can stand adversity, but give him power and see what he'll do. I said to the delegation, showing her in the minutes of the meeting, I said, I stand before you today. You gave me the power and you did judge whether I'm corrupt or not. That's still old to me today. I hope that I've been brief enough to cover some of the background. Now I want to get into what I think is essential here tonight. The role of the labor union and the role of the mine workers and the problems that we're faced with today. I firmly believe that I think there's enough awareness created today that if we're going to solve the fuel energy problem in this country, get this country in a position of self-sufficiency, we must go to coal. We must convert coal to our, whatever our needs may be. And we ought to have more concern for the general public and the people than we have for the profit motive, which has been so prevalent for all this many years. The coal industry has always been known as a feast or famine industry, and it need not be. If we're going to solve those problems, and we accept with reality that coal is the answer, we're going to need 50 to 75,000 more coal miners. As I stand here before you tonight, I am firm in my convictions that coal can be mined safe without all the senseless killing in the mainland, without all the other problems that we have, all the animosity that's been cultivated for years. What it takes to put all that to rest is for sensible people to sit down and be firm in their convictions and resolve these problems. And I've always felt like, and I'll say here tonight, at the risk of being repetitious, if there's any coal industry representative here, I don't mind to take the task for it. But I say that these problems can be resolved. And I'm willing to sit down with any operators, as I did at the bargaining table, to try to resolve the problem in a reasonable manner. And hope that our membership are respected for what they are, good taxpaying citizens. I think it's about time, you know, that the working class people in this country be recognized as someone who could be asked to do something once in a while. I don't think it hurts to ask. We're not working with the working miners. The union was handed to me. I didn't have to go out and go with something bigger than some of the older folks. Some of them may be here tonight. But because of my background, I knew what it was. And our contacts then were not very strong. If you ask the supervisor personnel, and I first went to working miners, you're subject to discharge. Without my people. I lasted 3 days before I was threatened with discharge. Grabby, husky young foreman, weighed about 240 pounds, came around. We were walking down from the, well, what they call the mule apartment. Still had the mule part of mine. Still had the other motor just now coming in. He jumped on an old miner, was bent over and crippled up. He should not have been working. Had there been some kind of retirement, he would not have been working. And there was no reason for it out first, except this was just the way of life with those men and supervisors. I weighed every bit of 100 pounds at 16 years old. The disrespect that's shown for old gentlemen is more than I can stand. So I did what might be considered a foolish thing. I confronted him. You can't talk this old gentleman. He said, you know, he said, you can be discharged for your actions. Yes, I guess I can. And I said, I suppose you can probably whip my backside too. And I said, when you do discharge, you got it to do. He said, well, that don't look like that'd be much of a job for you. I began looking then for a piece of a catwalk or something to kind of even up the odds. But fortunately, he thought better of it and he didn't do it. I was working with my granddad at the time. He'd been an old miner, started working in 1903. He said, young man, so I'm going to give you some advice. You're going to have to curb that temper, it's going to get you in a lot of trouble. Well, I didn't curb it until probably 20 years later. He was right about it, he did a lot of trouble. On several occasions, particularly when I was in service, when men of that stature and that size, physical pride, to say the wrong thing, I'd climb up their leg and hit them once anyway. Most of the time, I got a good count. I got to sit down at the store one night and I figured I'd been about 50 brawls and I hadn't won very many, possibly about four or five. I heard one, I saw a play one time, kind of hard on the pads and kind of hard on the blows too. But also, I heard many times my old granddad say that You get older, you get wiser.
As I got older, I didn't care about
As a result of what we did in this home, this state here, in my home state, 69, we started to reassert ourselves. We did something probably the greatest thing coal miners ever done for themselves. I'll stand here and make the charge and accusation as I did then. We did it without the help of our leadership. We did it with the help of our own selves. Sometimes people in news media, as Mr. Ross said, are sometimes prone to heap lavish praise on sometimes wrong people. I've become a apologist for my input in that program. But I'm also very conscious of the fact that there were 43,000 coal miners in the state that was together for the first time, I believe, in my entire life. I know it's a few sitting here tonight that got involved. I believe that they probably were sensitive as I was when people were saying this was something I had done. I had never done anything in my lifetime. I'm not about to do anything that's going on unless the membership of our union are together and with us and do it together. We were successful in establishing union democracy, and the membership of our union today have rights they never had before. There will be those who will refute that. But I ask them to substantiate the charges that they make. Today our membership can be outspoken. They can speak with a dissenting opinion. And I encourage them to do so. I do sometimes have to remind a few that you ought to show a little respect for one another as members of the same organization. But I'm not going to be swayed by a few that are vocal and a few that are perhaps misinformed. I am guided by the mandate of the majority. I see a potential today of solving the labor problems we have. I think during the contract negotiations last fall that we educated the so-called operators. The man who headed the operator's team made a statement on the first day. He said, "I don't know anything about mining coal." I said, "Mr. Wallace, that won't be a real problem. I said, before you leave the bargaining table, you'll be well versed in mining of coal. You may not come up with solutions, but you don't know what they are, what the problems are." I'm now getting a sufficient amount of free time to get down in the mine. I said to President Ford last Labor Day that if we ever don't expect to accomplish our ultimate goal of safety and mining in this country, particularly coal mining, that we had to have the cooperation of the industry, regulatory agencies, both at the federal and state level, and we recognized our commitment that we had to contribute our share also. It's only when we do this together. I am not mindful yet today that President Ford has really heard what I said. I really believe that I was telling actually what I thought. But we incorporated changes in the current agreement to give us some rights that we once had that was traded away for $2,000. I have a unilateral right along with the international office to go in any coal mine in the country in our jurisdiction. I don't have to notify any operator when I'm coming. All I have to do is allow us to check in and check out. I intend to visit as many coal mines as I possibly can for the remainder of the term, and for however long I shall remain as President of the United Mine Workers. I find conditions such as I found in one of the districts just recently. Those conditions will be dealt with and will be taken care of, for there will be no operation at that time. In the mine region, I found 2.5 foot depth. I know what the coal dust will do for you. I didn't tell the operator that, because I asked him, "What are you going to do?" But he said, "I want to send you that." I said, "When are you going to send you that?" He looked down and he was able to ask me, he said, "Right now." I said, "If you're here, you're going to be my fault." I left that operation in 9 minutes. I said, "Brother, are you coming back?" I said, "Yeah, I'm going to be back tomorrow." So they come down and say, "We'll be a week or two." I said, I hope when I come down again, I don't find those conditions. Don't just find the same violations twice, the same week. I realize this is the answer. Force is not the answer. I never recognized force as being a viable effect. Force is only effective when it's flat. Someone is going to have to wake up, realize. As I said to the Secretary of Labor last October, when I called a moral period, someone's going to have to wake up and recognize as a fact, a reality, that we do not have to have 78 men killed in a coal mining accident to understand it is a disaster when we have 100 men killed in the coal mines in any one year. I don't accept that. So long as I remain the position I'm in, and we have one fatality in mining, I'm going to strive to do better. There are other problems with mining. They have a serious management problem. And it stems from their own narrow-mindedness and their own short-sightedness many years ago. They didn't make any effort to set up any kind of training program. I must confess our union did not either. I'm aware today that there are elected officials in some of the districts that have a difficult task of trying to deal with the problems they had to go through. Because there's no training program. I hope in the near future we get a training program set up. I hope that the industry will recognize that they must solve their management problems, which I think are more detrimental for them than anything else they have to do. I'm very sensitive about management continually crying and harping that it's the 1969 Mine Health and Safety Act that's really killing our production. I've induced a few operators to go back and check the records, come back and tell me what they're saying. Come back and say, you're right. Our most productive operators are our safest operators. It took them about 40 years to begin to realize that. Well, I tell you right now, they don't have 40 years of record problems. I'm not going to be around another 40 years. I'm not going to wait. Not even another 10 years for them to decide these are about these problems. And I think that we're accomplished now in a major aspect of doing it ourselves if we like on the mine work. That is getting our money back. And we will train our own people to guard our safety division. I think there are many members of our safety division today that are just incapable of going in and finding a real problem. I think other uses of coal make it necessary that we make use of all these major technological advances to solve the fuel energy problem. I even go so far as to say that this is not exactly all that relevant to what I came here for tonight. But I am very sensitive about it nonetheless. I think it ties in with some of the problems we had with the fuel energy program. I think it's pertinent to the people that are here tonight. The president's proposal on the energy problem is certainly not accepted. I firmly believe, as I stand here tonight, that it's entirely possible to put a family side automobile on the road that is capable of getting 40 miles per gallon. I'm not talking about a small car, I'm talking about a family size car. I think it's time that we make use of all the major advances that have occurred in the last 30 years, some of which I know about. I served a 3-year apprenticeship as an auto mechanic when I came out of Liverpool World War II because of the serious injury I suffered then, wasn't able to go back to mine. One major advance we had then was water injection. Thank goodness you still get water today at a reasonable price. You might even find a place you might get it from that. It might be free again. But with the use of water injection, in 1947, we were able to increase the mileage of a car then was rather standard, a 41 Chevrolet on the road. We increased the mileage by 5 miles per gallon. If we want to be a bit more conservative and say today, well, perhaps it would do 4 miles per gallon. based on the information I now have, we are talking about a savings of gasoline of somewhere in the neighborhood of 176 million barrels of gasoline a year. Now, doesn't this sound like a more reasonable answer than saying we'll jack up the tariff on oil and we'll put a tax on the gasoline? We'll tax it so the poor working class people have to suffer even a greater economic loss. And there are other advances that have been suppressed by the oil industry. I spoke at an advanced research group in London about 3 weeks ago. Anytime there's any kind of management meeting, where there's generally always an oil company executive, there may be one here tonight. If there is, I'll apologize for what I say, what I'm going to say. He raised a question. I first spoke briefly to try to cover as many areas of interest as I could. I always felt like it's better to let people ask questions so you could try to address yourself with the interest that they were concerned. And I was a little bit critical of the oil industry for getting us in the circumstance we're in. The oil company executive got up and said, when I asked him these questions, he said, I didn't really like the statements you made when you were critical of the oil industry. Are you aware that our oil reserves are being rapidly depleted? What the oil industry is doing about it? This is a question you likely want to ask him, especially if you want to ask me, I don't believe. I said, yes, I want to have some time. I'm sure that you and the industry represent joint too, as well as a lot of government officials. I said, I'm aware of what you're doing about it too. Now, you run all over the world trying to buy all the oil you can get, it's for everyone else in the world, and bring in here, jack the prices up, and you don't even have the good sense to even pay some income tax here in this country so you can help eliminate some of the problems you create. I went on, that's a brief answer I can give you to what I said. Took 15 minutes to answer your question. You didn't ask any more questions. That's exactly what I feel about. I think that we in the coal industry, both management and our membership, certainly we're ready to fulfill our commitment. I think we can mine the coal, mine it safe, and we can supply the energy demand in this country at a price that the working class people can afford to pay. I want to perhaps get back on track again, and I want to say also that I'm not about to speak. I never protested. I was criticized in 72 when I was campaigning, and I wasn't much of a speak that well. I think what this country needs today, that's what I said then, I think still holds true today. We don't really need somebody an eloquent speaker, someone talk about the problem, but we really need someone to do something about it. And I think in the past few years I've tried to do something about the problems we had. And I got all the problems resolved. At least I worked 7 days a week off trying to solve the problem. We restored trade union democracy to our union. We have encourage the younger members of our union to get involved, attend their local meetings. We're trying to set up a program so that they can learn what a labor union is all about. And I hope somewhere in the future that it doesn't happen again. I hope that a member of our union is not placed in a position where he has to rise from the ranks of a local union, such as I did, and assume the direction of a labor organization that had almost been totally devoid of any kind of leadership for 20 years. It was a difficult task. I never said in 1972 it'd be easy. Believe me, it was. I'm not through with it yet. I said that I was sworn in on December 22, 1972. That I look forward to 5 years of hard work. I got a little better too, though, and it's really been hard. It's also the most gratifying. I think people are our greatest asset. And I think every day I can look back on the day after the close of the day and say that I've done something for our membership. I've done something for our fellow workers in this country. We recognize male and female today in our constitution. I saw pictures here on the slides that showed that women were working them out years ago. This wasn't new to me. It was in the mountain area where I grew up. After I was born, I was born in 1923. Everyone had to work. You either work or you starve. That's not an easy way to go. I would like to conclude my address here and say that I'm always grateful for the opportunity to come out in the public, speak on behalf of our membership, and if it's all right with Mr. Ross, I would like to entertain a few questions from the group here so that I can perhaps cover some area I didn't cover. Is that all right with you, Mr. Ross?
Sure.
Someone has a question.
Mr. Moore, recently you've been making statements asking for help getting better benefits for black lung victims. I'd like to know what specifically the union has done in research and to push black lung programs since you took office.
Well, we were successful in getting a $1.2 million grant from the federal government last year, an NILA program, to set up clinics to try to do something to ease the suffering, or those who are suffering. I recognize another very important aspect, that kind of program. If you have a facility to do something for those who are suffering, you also have a facility to examine those who do not yet know what they're suffering from. And I understand this problem, probably as well as any ordinary lady. And apparently, based on some of the reports I get from doctors, a lot better than some of the people in the medical profession. Certainly a lot better than the gentleman Mr. Ross referred to earlier. I want to take this opportunity to say that I'm grateful for Mr. Ross and Dr. Rasmussen for going to the University of Michigan. And the attention for me there, and the efforts on the part of, I believe, your son, enabled me to move that particular member of the medical profession out of the public health service. There was no way I could accept anyone in the medical service as late as last year, who made a statement in 1969 that only 1% of coal miners suffered from coal workers' pneumoconiosis, and they were not disabled. And there are some here in this audience that heard him say it. He said it again last year. But finally, I had risen to a position where I could actually exert some influence and get him removed. But we haven't got rid of him, he's still around. I'm not going to mention his name, but to quote a phrase I heard many times I was growing up, I could freely put the tar and feathers on him and run him out of country. Because we don't need him here in this country. But in addition to getting a grant to set up those clinics, we are pushing for legislation to make this type of legislation permanent. And as part of the legislation we're pushing, we firmly believe that we expect the industry to deal with this problem and bring it to its close, that they must be made to bear the cost of the debilitating disease that are owned by the coal miners' black lung disease. As long as they can get the general public, the general revenue fund to pick up the tab, they'll not do anything about it. I say the time has come that the general taxpaying public is picking up most of the tab. At the end of yourself, be saddled up with some responsibility, and then only will they face up to responsibility and try to bring it to a close. I still go to bat, however, to see any spinal operators coming out, and all you can see is the whites of their eyes. Now, those who are coal miners, you don't have to have a meter to measure the dust they're working. It's 500 times greater than all of them. And as long as I live, I'm going to continue to push for research to find if there's any way to ease the subject. I've been accused by the Public Health Service, Social Security Administration, and a few other bureaucrats of becoming emotional and bitter sometimes about this. Well, anytime that you have a problem in this country that's killing 3,000 or 4,000 coal miners, or 3,000 or 4,000 of anyone in this country, I think it's time that we show some concern. I visit with Mr. Coalfield, I go in the bathhouse now. When I hear a man breathing clear across the bathhouse, I know he's sick. We try to dress himself to that as a bargain. We try to give our membership some relief so that when he becomes disabled, that he can leave the mine and hopefully have some hope of living out his normal life. That's one another reason why I go in the mine, why I think it's important. To go in the mine to make sure that we get that problem taken care of. So, you can't really do anything about the disease. I know there's some doctors say you can do this and you can do that. Lively be a very close personal friend of Dr. Rasmussen. And we talked about this thing probably several thousand times. He doesn't yet know anything we're going to do about it. He does, and I'm not going to be likely receptive to what someone else might say. I would like to treat him so he can do some research. But now he gets the time to do some research. He was in 1987. I would appreciate it if the hospital would be a little bit more receptive and recognize the disease for what it is. 3 years ago, I was in a hospital, and an old friend of ours was in the last throes of death from heart trouble. His wife called and said he wasn't going to make it tonight. A friend of mine got together, we drove down, we drove about half the night. Got into the hospital about 3 o'clock in the morning. A friend of mine said, how are we going to get in? I said, we're going in. Well, he's going to have any now. I said, hang the visit now. We're going in. I got in his room, and the nurse came in and said, what are you doing in here? I said, my friend here is dying. I said, I'm sick. Oh, he's not telling the truth. He's going to be at school when he's asked. Just last week, I had another friend. Another co-worker. Died in a hospital in my home area. He saw a hospital. They let him lay in the emergency room all night. With an intern to do something for him, probably didn't have the slightest idea what was wrong with him. Claiming they didn't have any beds. And I happen to know that they had 4 empty beds all night long. After him laying in this hospital all night long, he finally got him in the bed, but it was too late. If the medical profession expects me to accept that, and I'll be bitter and emotional about it, then they better take another look. Well, I'm going to take a look at the hospital to see the medical profession. And I know that some of them in charge there make $4,000 a year. And I'll tell you what I think about that. No one's worth that kind of money.
What are you going to do about the miners' pension for the miners of black farmers in the state?
We tried to improve the pension program. We did, I think, as much as we possibly could. In the current agreement, we're putting almost $1 billion in the fund. This money is going to be invested properly like it could have been before. And we do have a provision now when a miner has become disabled that does reach hospitalization. And you can get some benefit. That's only beginning.
I got 5 welfare calls.
You have 5 welfare calls?
Yeah, I got two more Friday.
Did you hit any car take my friend before? We had several thousand of them that had their hospital car take my friend before. When I left the mine in 1970, I was out 8 days and my hospital car was ready. Well, that was a surprise. I knew what.
Well, I'll keep mine. I'll keep mine. I'm just your rate, so I'll keep
mine. That's right. You keep the top of practice to take hospital
car. Well, I got 5 cars. I couldn't understand why I got 2 more the other day.
Well, sometimes, you know, when people deal with computers, a computer can only do what you program it for. If you program mistakes in a computer, that's what you get out of it, mistakes. Someone else has a question?
Yes. Yes, sir. You know, not only do you not think a doctor for 400,000, Mr. Robson, you know, working on my team. I've worked with a clinic and I'm a doctor, and I have an interest in energy policy to address yourself a little bit earlier. And a lot of the, this is something I mentioned in our course before, but a lot of the thrust of current energy spending and research and development is towards nuclear fission. And I feel strongly about that as you feel about oil companies. And I don't know if you folks have got yourselves involved much in that, but you're in a position to do a lot more about it than I am. And basically my feeling about that is that the nature of the folks who are getting into nuclear fission now are the same oil companies and the big corporations that control and profiteered all those highway programs and all those gas guzzling cars. And the problem with nuclear fission is the pollutants that it creates. You know, you hear about the coal pollution, the pollutants that nuclear fission creates, last for thousands of years, and there's no way of doing nothing about them except sitting on them and trying to keep them stored. I wondered, as I said, I feel that's probably one of the big directions that energy's going in, when it, but we really don't have any sense going in there, but a lot of policies going in there for folks who want power for the same reason that we want power. If the UMW has spent any time in its policy considerations about addressing itself to those issues.
Yes. Ramon's aware that well back 4 or 5 years ago, one trip I was traveling to Coastal and I heard appropriations were made to appropriate out $2 billion for coal research. At the same time, they appropriate $2 billion for atom research. And I said then, it's about time somebody wake up and realize it's going the wrong direction. They should have reversed it. Spent $2 billion for coal research and atom research. We have the potential answers for these problems. And I want to take this opportunity to correct myself a little bit. I hope I didn't leave the impression to you that all the people in the medical profession, all the doctors, are bad, because they're not. I think one of the, in addition to being a very good friend of mine, Dr. Atkinson, is also one of the best members of the medical profession that I know of. Because he came out and took a stand to have to work in the last few years, the coal mine. He's not a native to this state, he's from out in the West. He had all kinds of threats, and almost anyone he could make. And the medical profession didn't really appreciate what he was doing either. All he was doing was telling the truth. And I do know a number of doctors that believe in the oath that they do. They believe in doing what is right. And I had the good fortune in the few years I spent in the Army hospital in World War II, before I was able to get out, to have a doctor that sat down and explained to me one time. He said, there are two kinds of doctors, the good and the bad. He said, the good are generally very good, and the bad are generally very bad. But he said that there are also the same kind of doctors. Some believe in the profession they got into, and they do whatever they can to help people who are suffering. They don't worry about how much money they make. There are those that that's your soul in. That's all they care about, how much money they make. He said, but they both do that well. And I think a doctor that is good and agrees on the oath to become a doctor, I believe he'll do all right. And I certainly hope that the people of the country will not be the silent majority of my people. I hope they recognize those in the medical profession that are trying to do what's right and give the credit to them.
Let me come back to my point, which is what I want to mention. I see the UMWA through pushing for significant monies in R&D, research and development at the federal level. Making fuel out of coal, making liquid fuel out of coal and burning cars is something the Germans were doing, in World War II, is something that certainly seems very feasible, but to my knowledge, there isn't the same kind of big push there is for that very fancy, very poisonous technology nuclear fission. There's nothing like that going on in
the pool. Well, I'm sure, at least I know in reality, that this country is very not as capable as the potential to come up with improvements over the methods that the Germans were using in World War II. I was over in World War II fighting Germans. They were powering their tanks, the planes on the fuel made out of coal. Plus the fact that the people in South Africa have been running their automobiles for the last 20 years on them. They don't call it gas, but it runs automobiles. And today they're selling 6 cents a gallon. Wherever it is that they can bring it here, I do buy some of it. I won't care what they call it. I'd rather pay 6 cents a gallon than I would pay $1.50, which is what the oil companies are going to do. I said in response to a question last year when our former president, my own name, brought in 300 oil company executives to solve the energy problem. I said, it's like putting a fox in the hen house. These were the same people who got us in this trouble. And the reason why there hasn't been any real effort made to solve the other problems or find other uses for other methods of fuel energy is because they control it all. They own 70% of the coal.
Now, they're not about to do it any kind of a gasification process, liquefaction, or any other kind of use of coal, so long as they control it all and can maneuver and manipulate the price. When one oil company bought a operation that's in our jurisdiction, one of the members of the board of directors said, it'll only be a matter of time that we'll have the price of coal up equal to the price of coal for oil. I think they're going to do that.
I don't know if he understands it or not. Back in 1950, I was working at a mine, and they bought a ton of coal off of us each month and experimenting to see how much gasoline they could get out of that ton of coal and how much fertilizer they could get out of it. The Bureau of Mines at Morgantown was doing that back in the 50s. And they would dump the fertilizer in the river and burn the gasoline up there, and they were making it for less than 15 cents a gallon. That was in the 50s, out of coal.
I don't take another question back here. You were very much concerned about the other alternative sources of fuel energy. As I said earlier, briefly, we think coal. I think that some of the problems that we have with coal can be dealt with. I think we can get the sulfur out of coal. I remember 1950 when the coal market was down, and they had what we always call coal tipping. Some of you didn't know what I'm talking about. Now we have a coal preparation plant. All the coal tibbles done, they just grade the coal, they crush it and grade it, take out a little bit of slate. Not too much of that if it was too much complaint. And the company's worth coal, you gotta get the sulfur out of it, we're not gonna die you coal. Well, then they went to the processor plant and washed it. They crushed a little bit smaller and they got some of the sulfur out. They got it down as well as an acceptable level. I say today, when they're put on notice, that they have to get the sulfur out of the coal, they can get it out. I want to further clarify that by saying we have an operation in Nova Scotia in Canada, which is one of our districts. They have a processing plant up there. It's a little bit different type than what we have here. The content of sulfur in their coal up there is 1.2%. And they take that 1.2% sulfur out of that coal, take all the impurities out, even the salt. It's a little bit salt that comes from the coal. And you process that coal in three different categories. Metallurgical byproduct, what's called bitumen. Utility can use the bitumen to make power. And then that water is filtered back to that plant and researchers are drink. They drink the water comes out of it. And that's how it fits. They do it in salt. They use that salt and mix it. And they do it at a cost of 99 cents a ton. I have a research department now working on what is the cost that they're charging now. I've long time been aware of the fact you can go to the SEC and get the information you need. You've got to find a way to get it. Now, I'm firmly convinced that thing at night. But we find the cost of being charged in this country today, processing coal, by the coal industry, we're going to find it's about $2 a ton. They can do that in Canada. For 95 cents a ton, Canada has not escaped inflation, although the dollar is worth about 90 cents right now. They still have their inflationary problems too. They do it in Canada for 95 cents a ton. They can certainly do it here for not more than a dollar and a half.
Basically. Mr. President, I'd like to direct the question. First, I want to make a comment. This is coming down to the school. But the statement that I would like to make, and that is, I find, and I think it is correct, that in our automobile industry, quite frequently, people find a way to the right of action. The life of the government. To me, it is a cause where if they would give that individual a percent, let's say a very small percent, you would have an incentive. And the coal mines I hear is likewise. I don't know 100%, but I hear anything that you would have in the inventive type, let's say it's 50%, or just a very 7/10 of a very small percentage to what you would contribute as an invention. But whatever you're working on, and if you have any dedication for improvement or invention, you don't get. So I was just wondering, wouldn't that help? Even in the coal mines and the American automobile industry?
It would certainly help. But I'm thinking right now, if someone could come up with a new type of operation that would increase the mileage on automobile, say the average automobile would get 50 miles a gallon, the oil companies would be all losing your time, who he is, they buy him out.
got to breathe, we've got to get on the market. Now, there's been a lot of these advances that they have not got on the market. Water injection was tackled by the industry itself. Now, I recognize that the utilities are trying to do something about it 30 years ago. But today, we finally, I think, are beginning to recognize. I don't think the intent for it is recognized in the same time what we do. Today is the time to make use of all those major technological advances and explore and find other ways. This, to me, is a better alternative than what the President's proposal was, which I said, I remember just briefly, had the effect to put $200 or $300 in your pocket, in your left-hand pocket, and take $1,000 out of your right-hand pocket. That don't solve a problem. Yes, sir.
Number, I agree with the president. I will external that the ministry is willing for the cause of the new contract for the recent contract to the could you tell the audience perhaps if you have that knowledge of what the price of coal has moved to in the last few years, where it was, where it is today, to verify that.
Well, the projected cost during the bargain, the operators for producing a ton of coal, just the irrigator, I don't believe it, was $8 a ton. And they were selling it anywhere from $17 a ton. They eat one train load while we're bargaining, they get one train load to the West Coast, which I don't know what's going on there. They were getting $120 a ton of that coal, the Japanese were buying, metallurgical coal. But it wasn't at all, they weren't shipping any metallurgical coal. That's the first 2 weeks of the master shutdown, of course. The fuel company sure didn't have any sales. One of the major fuel companies was buying coal during the second week of the shutdown. The spot market, the Wall Street market price, I think the highest price was $120 a ton during the highest bargain. I've seen one coal operator after the contract was ratified, I went back down. He said, while you were bargaining with us, that I would get $56 a ton for my coal. He said, now that it's selling out of sight, so I'm only getting 17. I said, you're still making a pile of money. I said, I'm glad it stayed up while we were bargaining. If it hadn't, you wouldn't have gotten as much out of it as you did. It's difficult to assess the price of coal, what they're selling it for. It's really hard to track that down because they're not really monitoring any kind of way where their information is active. You can't really accept with reality what they say that it's costing the mines on coal. I did manage some of the mines I worked in. We were a small mine, 3 or 4 units, where I could get an active reading. And I can just tell you one instance of one thing I worked in 1960. I did get access to the information of it. Reports the cost, the tons per man, what they're selling for. At that particular mine, it was costing 62 cents a ton of mining coal. They were mining 41 tons per man, and they were selling at the chisel. They didn't have a preparation plant. For $10 a quarter a ton. And they wouldn't even let the roof coal, they drilled holes to put up roof coal. They made them catch the dust in a powder box and carry it back out of the face. They didn't want that coal. At the same time, in 1950, I could produce several hundred invoices where they were selling slack. That was the fourth grade of coal they had come out of the chisel, not preparation plant, it wasn't wire. They were selling slack for $7 and a half a ton. And yet I had a corporate executive, and they were crying about the bargain table. I said, I thought you'd be with all of you, I'd out of your name. I said, you can get me into a long-term contract. But they still were doing all right there. Their profits were up last year by 50%. But the price is down now. I firmly believe what I said. No reason to raise the price of gold. Except your little price.
And I read in the Fairmont Times this year recently where you made a proposal on the Capitol Hill. According to how many years the man may work. And if I remember correctly, I think you stated that some other higher-ups, if the compensation, local state compensation, should to their companies 3 days as possible due to compensation of all the black money. Now my question to you, sir, is this. Now they, when it comes to where the man's eligibility, where he's held in percentages, this is the departmental data that we know. 10%, 20%, or whatever. But any doctor, all qualified in medical field, will tell you any time you get four and off, you can design with no rate of increase. And do you think, sir, my question to you, do you go along with the percentage that way?
No. I think my man is not able to work the occupation he worked at, so he's disabled.
Right.
Not in a percentage. When you're unable to work, you're unable to work.
That's right.
And it's been common practice here in this state. I filed a compensation claim in 1971, and I got the usual 15%. And yet, we put in another 5 minutes, and I shut up. I did. That's the customary practice here.
Right.
Do you think that the possibility that Congress will pass the U.S. Black Hospital, and if they don't, do you have any time to talk to the other side?
Well, any plans right now that lately we had worked on in committee, I don't think we'll ever get what I would really like to get. We're asking for a 15-year presumption. We're hoping to get this. But if we don't get what we want, we're going to keep hammering. I'm supposed to see a doctor in the morning when I go back in, be a damn high up to the problem. I was down 3 months ago and he said if you behave yourself, try to get off that 7-day schedule, you might be around another 15 or 20 years. If I am, I'm going to be leaning on it for another 15 or 20 years to enact legislation that will do the job the way it should. One reason I firmly believe in the 15-year presumption requirement is legislation. If I went through these examinations, I saw many of the thousands of our co-owners with these same kind of examinations. Some of the examinations they go through are useless. The one I went through, the state compensation, I could have gone through the whole bit in 30 minutes. But because I was a little bit vocal, both days, the 2 days, both days I was last to go through. It didn't bother me too much. We're gonna keep on with the stressful laws. A lot of friends tell me in 1969, as well as some of the other things, we were all told we were crazy. 1972, we went back and we got the amendments enacted. It took 15 months of hard work to get that done. And again, we were told we were crazy. And my dad used to say, some good comes of everything. I began to wonder, you know, all the spiritual things, what good can come of that? I finally, it's kind of dawned on me at the end of 1972. That's a long time to apply it. The main cause, people down there afraid that will brought me off. I may be doing what I think is right, and at least you do the reason why. But I don't know anybody out of war period. We do have it in current agreement. I see 50 years in the war period for what I think is betterment of our membership. I would. Last year, I was promptly criticized by the energy thing. Well, I just wanted to reduce the stock value. I said, no, I've made a statement. In fact, why I called it a military, I want somebody to recognize that we lost over 120 some men last year. We lost them one at a time. I said, that was a disaster. I said, the operator represented that I had with discretionary authority to call him. I said, I wanted to. If I wanted to really reduce the stockpile up to 110, you'd do better than 5. But you can't convince. I said to the operator when I first met him in 1972, in a brief introductory meeting, there have been some changes since then. There have been some progress. At the end, they realized, you know, I'm no freak of some sort. But I said to them then, that I've never caught them in two here. I'm now trying to catch them in two a little bit.
Well,
there are gotten about the region for everyone. There were many ways we could have gone about negotiating, and the door is not closed. We still go back and improve the pension. We improved, we got the greatest improvement in the pension program that we ever had. Someone could have done this 20 years ago. When I took office, the pension fund was going broke. We were able to put the brakes on it, spend $34 million for a year, and then taking in. It's no use for me to sit and stand here and tell you the sad truth. If the funds had been managed right properly to start with, there would have been billions of dollars in that fund today. Someone didn't see fit to do that. And I'm trying to correct that. And I said in 1972 that I thought that the pensions for the pension miners of our union ought at least get a $50 raise. Well, they got more than $50. I looked at an old pledge card that I carried in 1972 in my office in Washington, D.C. And I enumerated everything that I said in 1972 that I wanted to be done. That's what I'm trying to do. I haven't finished one term of office yet. I've fulfilled most of what I said. I went beyond the expectations in some areas. But somewhere we had to get back to start. Under this agreement, if they go out here and hire a young man off the street, and I'm sure he's going to object to this, if you hire a young man off the street and go to work tomorrow, and he becomes disabled, he don't lose his hospital, and he gets a minimum pension. Someone should have done this for all our DVD brothers 20, 30 years ago. And I hope for it one time. My first term of office is up. I hope that I can come out here and see the membership and say that we have the highest pension of any labor group in the country. And I think it's now a possibility. We're going to have to work it.
Well, my point was that after the man succeeded, then there is no pension there for the family.
Under the old agreement, what happens if you were a pensioner and you passed away, what happened to your wife?
Oh, my wife.
I say, what would happen under the old agreement?
Oh, I don't know. I will agree with you on this. There should have been billions.
Yeah, but let me ask you a question. You tried to do something for everyone at the rear. It was not property claimed in many areas. It was complex and difficult. But there were some areas that there was no effort made to explain contact over them. Under the old agreement, if you were a pension miner and you expired, your wife had hospitalization for a year or two, then nothing.
Yes.
Under this agreement, if you're a pensioner, you're going to have to give your wife these hospitalizations forever.
That is true.
That was an improvement. And that only cost $30 million a year to get that out of the office. And I fought him for 80 days to get him to agree, and not only agree to that, but to provide hospitalizations for all the pensioners, all the widows of pensioners, which are 35 to 40 thousand. One operator representative said, we're not going to stay here at the bargaining table and clean up 400 years of gross inequity. I know that you're going to make a pretty good start on about their first 100. And so it cost them $30 million to provide hospitalization for your wife some had to eat. And that isn't enough. I want to go back. The door's not closed. I want to go back and keep negotiating. And try to bring all that up to the same level. Sometimes we lose sight of the fact. It's like the proverb that when a man was complaining about not having any shoes, long came a man who had no feet. Sometimes we lose sight of the fact that there are some things that should have been done. And it's really a tragedy that someone didn't know before. But I'm concerned about our membership. I don't believe that the team acted. I don't believe anybody that's joining more concerned. I talked to a lot of widows now. You remember last year, we had to make the first change. We got just a little bit of money. We put the brakes on the debt spending. And we're able to go back and give the hospitalization to those who were disabled and to the widows of those who were killed in that area. And I knew when I made the change, I was able to bring that change around.
that I was going to get some flack on here. But I didn't hide in Washington, D.C. I come down to Goldfield, and the widows, the pension miners, they did, they raised questions. But today it's a different story than what years ago. I sat down with them, and I said, let me put it in proper perspective. I said, I had a choice. I could give you your hospital or I could give the widow of Peru, who's got a poor small children going to, her hospital bill, but couldn't get the boat in. Which one would you rather see have the hospital? I talked to over, I say, 1,000 widows as we made that change. I took the time to sit down before they deserved that place. I never had one that I would have been with them. So what I've done was right. And I said, we're going to get the bargain table. We're going to get the hospitalization for all the widows of St. Mary's. Today, they're going to get it. They haven't already got the hospitalization, they're going to get it. They're pleased about that. I wish we could give them the pension benefits also. But I said earlier, the door's not closed.
My question may be understand, but for the older coal miners, retired coal miners, I felt hurt when I read my mine journal, and there wasn't anything in there for us reserved for our families to be retired. Understand?
Well, I knew
that to start off with the new fellow that's coming in, he gets that protection. But us older ones didn't. But I understand that it's your position, yeah. Because that all of them millions was back way back when, if they were then there, we would have had something. But now I realize that you can't get something for this.
It's gonna take a while, but I'm not gonna quit like that, John. I'd like to say that I have two very old friends of mine, very good friends. In front of me in a bargaining conference in my home district. They helped to bring about the change, they helped to bring about the benefits and the back on program. Both of them today are on Social Security, minor pension, the back on benefits. Both of them got the state benefits also. And they were critical because there was a little bit of difference in the pension benefits between those who were serving the back on and those who were not. And they confronted, they were very critical. And I said, please give me time to answer the question. I said, I could give you the same amount of pension benefits and increase, but I could not provide protection for your wife if you now have an attorney living. I said, which would you rather have $15 or $20 more on your pension for the hospitalization for your wife when something happens to you? And I feel in commission after I came from back to Washington, D.C. I got two very nice letters from both of them. They just took them a while to understand. I know that it was difficult for them to understand. That's why I don't want to hide D.C. I come down. That's why I want to explain to you that the door is not closed. And I said in 1972 when I was chief of the office on our hold, I hope to see every member of the mining workers get the same retirement. I think that's a reality. I think it's going to be a possibility. But I think no one in Florida should get a full salary of retirement. And so long as I remember, at least not now, there'll be no full salary of retirement. But there were those who thought they were going to get it. But they did. That's what they care about. You deserve as much pension, brother, as I do. I don't care if I was 20 years in Washington, D.C. You deserve the same thing out there. That's the way I feel about it.
I know you.
I'm going to need somebody to tough road to hold.
Mr. President?
Yes.
What percentage of coal commodity in the country that many might be out there? Is it 75%, 80%, 90%,
100%? It's about
100%. You know, I do.
It's about 70%.
We got
an organizing drive going on. It's just really none of the amount of Eastern Texas. And we got a chunk of that now. We've got the 20 operations down that we've taken in the last year.
Well, in the last part of the country now, there's only increased tonnage. From 30 million itself to 300 million in 10 years. The organization is determined that organize it completely. If they do produce that 300 million, they make it 100%. If they produce that coal, we're going to be, we intend to have all the coal mines in country out here. There was no organizing done in 20 years. We've already had four mines in the last 2 years, we did in 20 years previous. We're just now getting here at that. They're going to mine that coal in the west, and we're going to get under our jurisdiction.
January, and I was out, and they had directed me didn't mean, I know what you mean, but I was asking a question.
Yeah, what I'm saying is, excuse me, what I'm saying, was they did that, it didn't cost them all that. As long as the money that pays the black hundred, the money that I was doing revenue side, the toll hour, it will not pay the responsibility. Same way with land savings. You go out here and get a toll up the fine by the fine that you levy by the land savings bill pack. Fine of $10,000, somebody has to pay $10, then it's obvious that they're going to pay $10. We could go out here and street and we come to a red light. If we knew it's going to be fined a quarter, if we run, got caught, we won't act, we'd run, but if we're going to get fined $25, we won't act, we'll go to the red light. We're not running that red light, it's going to cost us too much money. That's a comparison. They're going to have to pay. And until they do pay, it will not take up the responsibility. Well, that's who they have to do. Somewhere up road, someone in Washington is going to get that. It's someone in the state out there that's going to get that. They're going to be begin to realize that we need business. If we say safety is our highest priority, we're going to mind cold safety, we're not going to mind it all. We need it. Might take them a while. It might be a little bit of not knocking them on, but it's good.
President Miller, you mentioned safety. What was the thought about waiting? Gas in mind, and then you want to get some years and years to help you with coal and gas and steel. Is there any other consideration of doing something to save those in some way? Thank you for that
waste
and accepting those funds.
There again, you have a mind that's very heavy conservation investment. We have one down to 28. They liberate 20 million cubic feet of equipment in 24 hour period. And also, it's owned by oil companies. And as long as they can get plenty of oil to bring in for the price they get for us, they just let it go on out. They don't even do much of the job you can get out of mine. They have it now, accumulated for 20% in the McCarran Airways, that mine. It's one I have the greatest fear of exploding. 20 million cubic foot of methane for 24 hour period in that mine, they could leave that gas off and not to use it. They're clean burning fuel. In Nova Scotia mine, they drill holes down between the coal and pump it out. And their coal up there is under the ocean floor. They call it submarine mine. I was in their oldest mine there like the last year, or year before last. 5 miles out on these oceans. It might be an overburden on top of the coal. And they told me that on the pipes that they were pumping the gas out, that it was about 85% through methane. I don't know if they were using there. I suppose the 85% they probably could use a good amount of oil, but you have to have something to write it for.
President, when it comes to creation, what is calling the creation? Two corporations fight between one another, and then the general public has to suffer, right? But, you know, some of the people who pay the ball that comes about gaining and growing is kind of complex for the youth to come to.
Fighting claims, so the security administration has been all the claims inside.
budget, tire this and that here. Sure you got another question?
If you know something about that 105 miles in that ocean, I've been running by that.
All the coal in Nova Scotia does not crop out on land. It crops up in the ocean floor. They go back on land and straight out on what it is. They sink a shaft down and then they drive with the rock type manner, in this manner. They drive down and that coal is on 26 degrees below, out on the ocean floor. They drive down to pick up the coal again, and then they drive the development. Parallel to the slope of 26 degrees. Now all the mining there is long wall. The long wall, these rocks where they come back out. The reason makes them out, he'll set up the long wall. Very high grade seams, they got 5 seams of coal at this mine. They had a series of lumps back in the 50s, about 150 something else fuel in there. And that lump was caused by the recovery coal. And the ocean full of coal, the water didn't come down. It's about 12 or 14 inches of that rock roll. They call that a bump in there. Everywhere you go in different countries, you find different terminology. Like down in my home area, Florida, you know, they all have a man hauling. That's a man car. That's a land for wagon. Nova Scotia is the bop. In England, it's the setup. It's all the same thing.
Well, you said the long wall.
Yeah,
well, the old one is 1,400 foot from there up to the ocean, right?
1,900 foot.
1,900 foot. Well, I know the long wall, what does it try to do, right? Has it been used to process and come down?
I never placed them on when I was there, but I suppose it does. I suppose it's somewhere similar to potash mining in the west. Obviously, I didn't work there, but I thought some guys did. And those potash mines, they have salt pools out there, an iron salt pool, equal time. And they take it all out, all the potash. It's just time it all comes in. It does it break. I talked to one management personnel there, working in a car band. He's been there about 15 years. The largest piece of roof that he saw fall was a nice flag mite fell out of it. It was a fall. So it's outside of a walking stick. That's all he's thinking about there. I didn't check in with the status or anything, but they didn't talk about it. And I did ask him about recovery, because he come back and recover all the coal. You know, we're wasting a lot of coal here and it's cutting down. By what I call cut and covering. I first went to work in mine, built rooms about 50 months and put them on pillars, about 10 of them. And put them on pillars, if you bring it all, and then you bring it all, if you got down over the block of that, you don't want to fall. You got kind of loaded. The natural tendency run off these. They didn't let you run off these. You got your source loaded out, or else you're dead. Today, I worked with some nice things then. They hauled these cows down, they left more coal and they got out. Before we have an abundance of coal, I think this was the word in those years. Of course, we have an abundance of coal. I think we have a responsibility to mine it and leave something to the generations we hope to come along mine that. We don't do better than what we've been doing the last 4 or 5 years. I don't know whether I want to be a part of that generation come along mine it or not. But we really foul things up, so they may not want to come along. However, thank you. I really appreciate y'all being here.
Besides the very both constructive and controversial recognizes that he's come into a district in which all of us who are objective know there are many viewpoints here, and the courtesy and the pleasantness with which we treat each other, I think, are important in carrying on the debate inside the union as well as in American politics. So again, on behalf of the community, I want to thank President Miller for coming and being with us tonight, and thank all of you for your courtesy and your attention.